This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Within You is the Power by Henry Thomas Hamblin. Preface. There is a power lying hidden in man, by the use of which he can rise to higher and better things. There is in man a greater self that transcends the finite self of the sense man, even as the mountain towers above the plain. The object of this little book is to help men and women to bring their inward powers of mind and spirit into expression, wisely and in harmony with universal law, to build up character, and to find within themselves that wondrous self, which is their real self, and which, when found, reveals to them that they are literally and truly sons of God and daughters of the Most High. There is no way whereby the discipline of life can be avoided. There is no means by which fate can be tricked, nor cunning device by which the great cosmic plan can be evaded. Each life must meet its own troubles and difficulties, each soul must pass through its deep waters, every heart must encounter sorrow and grief. But none need be overwhelmed in the great conflicts of life, for one who has learned the great secret of his identity with the universal life and power dwells in an impregnable city, built upon and into the rock of truth against which the storms of life beat in vain. While this little work does not offer any vain promises of an easy life, for if this were possible, it would be the greatest of all disasters, but rather endeavors to show how to become so strong that life looks almost easy by comparison. The life or fate does not change or become easier, but the individual alters and becomes stronger, yet it does show the reader how to avoid making his life more difficult than it need be. Most people's lives would be less filled with trouble and suffering if they took life in the right spirit and acted in harmony with universal law. It is hoped that this little book may help many to come into harmony with life's law and purpose and thus avoid much needless suffering, to find the greater self within, which discovery brings with it a realization of absolute security, to bring into expression and wisely use their inner spiritual and mental forces and thus enter a life of overcoming and almost boundless power. End of the preface. Chapter 1. Infinite Life and Power. Man possesses, did he but know it, illimitable power. One, this power is of the spirit, therefore it is unconquerable. It is not the power of the ordinary life, or finite will, or human mind. It transcends these, because being spiritual, it is of a higher order than either physical or even mental. This power lies dormant, and is hidden within man until he is sufficiently evolved and unfolded to be entrusted with its use. Thought is a spiritual power of tremendous potency, but this is not the power of which we speak. By thought, man can either raise himself up and connect himself with the powerhouse of the universe, or cut himself off entirely from the divine inflow. His thought is his greatest weapon, because by it he can either draw on the infinite or sever himself, in consciousness but not in reality, from his divine source. Through the divine spark within him, which is really his real self, man is connected with the infinite. Divine life and power are his, if he realizes that they are his. So long as he is ignorant of his oneness with the divine source of all life, he is incapable of appropriating the power that is really his. If, however, he enters into this inner knowledge, he finds himself the possessor of infinite power and unlimited resources. This power then is God's, yet it is also man's, but it is not revealed to him until he is fit to be entrusted with it. It is only when man realizes his oneness with his divine source that he becomes filled with its power. Many teachers and initiates lament the fact that certain secrets are being spread broadcast today, secrets that in the past were kept closely guarded. They fear that unillumined and unevolved people may make destructive use of spiritual power. This, to the writer, appears to be improbable. It is true that strong personalities who have a great belief in their own power to achieve and succeed draw unconsciously on hidden powers and thus are able to raise themselves high above their fellows. The use, however, that they can make of spiritual power for base purposes is limited and is not to be feared. There are others, of course, who are misusing their powers. These are black magicians, and while they may do a certain amount of harm, they become reduced, ultimately, to beggary and impotence. There are also others who spend the whole of their spare time searching for knowledge of this very subject. They read every occult book they can lay hands on, but they never find that for which they seek. There are spiritual powers and influences that withhold the eyes of the seekers from seeing until they are ready for the revelation. When man, in his search for truth, has given up all selfish striving after unworthy things and has ceased to use his self-will in conflict with the greater will of the whole, he is ready for the revelation of his oneness with the infinite. Yielding implicitly to the will of the whole may seem to the unillumined an act of weakness, yet it is the entrance to a life of almost boundless power. Man is not separate from his divine source and never has been. He is, in reality, one with the infinite. The separation which he feels and experiences is mental and is due to his blindness and unbelief. Man can never be separated from spirit, for he himself is spirit. He is an integral part of one complete whole. He lives and moves and has his being in God, universal, omnipresent spirit, and God's spirit dwells in him. The majority of people are unaware of this intimate relationship with the divine, and because they are unaware or because they refuse to believe it, they are, in one sense, separated from the inner life of God. Yet this separation is only in their thoughts and beliefs, and not in reality. Man is not separated and never can be, yet so long as he believes that he is separate and alone, he will be as weak and helpless as though he actually were. As soon as man realizes the truth of his relationship to the infinite, he passes from weakness to power, from death unto life. One moment he is in the desert, afar off, weak, separate, and alone. The next he realizes that he is nothing less than a son of God, with all a son's privileges and powers. He realizes, in a flash, that he is one with his divine source, and that he can never be separated. He awakens also to the fact that all the power of the infinite is his to draw upon, that he can never really fail, that he is marching on to victory. It will thus be seen how great is the power of man's thought. While thought is not the power of the spirit, it is the power by which man either connects himself up with the infinite power, opening himself to the divine inflow, or cuts himself off and separates himself from his spiritual source. Thus, in a sense, man is what he thinks he is. If he thinks he is separate from God and cut off from his power, then it is as though this were really the case, and he is just as impotent and miserable as though he actually existed apart from God. On the other hand, if he thinks and believes that he is one with the infinite, he finds that it is gloriously true, and that he is really a son of God. If he believes and thinks that he is a mere material being, then he lives the limited life of a material being, and is never able to rise above it. But if, on the contrary, he thinks and believes that he is a spiritual being, then he finds that he possesses all the powers of a spiritual being. Again, if he thinks that his work is difficult and that he is not equal to his tasks, he finds that really his tasks are difficult and beyond his powers. Yet on the other hand, if he believes his work is easy, or at any rate within his powers, he finds that such is the case and that he can do his work with ease. The power within is infinite, for by faith in it, man is directly coupled up with the spiritual power of the universe. The divine spark within him connects him to the sacred flame, thus making him potentially a god in the making. A change, then, must take place within man before he can enter into his divine inheritance. He must learn to think after the spirit, that is, as a spiritual being, instead of after the flesh, that is, as a material creature. Like the prodigal son, he must come to himself and leave the husks and the swine in the far country, returning to his father's house, where there is bread of life enough and to spare. End of the chapter. Chapter 2. The Overcoming of Life's Difficulties. The true object of life is that man may attain wisdom through experience. This cannot be accomplished by giving in to the difficulties of life, but only by overcoming them. The promises of God are not made to those who fail in life's battle, but to those who overcome. Neither are there any promises that man shall have an easy time and be happy ever afterwards. Yet it is after this that the majority of people are forever seeking an easy life, a good time, freedom from suffering and care. But in spite of all their seeking, they can never find that which they desire. There is always a fly in the ointment of their pleasure, something that robs them of true happiness, or possibly combinations of circumstances conspire to upset all their plans. Life is a paradox. The true object of life is not the attainment of happiness, yet if we attain the true object of life, we find happiness. Those who are ignorant of life's true purpose, and who seek happiness high and low, year after year, fail to find it. Like a will-o'-the-wisp, it forever eludes them. On the other hand, those who recognize the true object of life and follow it, attain happiness without seeking for it. In times past, people have made God a convenience. They have thought they could drift through life learning none of its discipline, and then, when in trouble, or things were not to their liking, they could pray to God and have the unpleasant circumstances taken away. The same idea is prevalent today. People have left the old orthodoxy and looked to various cults and isms to get them out of their difficulties. They do not believe now that they can curry special favor with God by prayer, but they firmly believe that they can get what they want from the invisible by demanding it. They think that by this means they can have their own way after all. By this they mean having a good time, with no unpleasant experiences, trials, difficulties, adversities. They are, however, merely chasing rainbows. The easy life they seek constantly eludes them, simply because there is no such thing. The only life that is easy is the life of the strong soul who is overcome. His life is not easy in reality, but appears relatively so because of his strength. It is impossible to have an easy life, and if it were possible, then life would be not worth living, for the sole object of life is the building of character and the attainment of wisdom through experience. Life to all of us must always be full of difficulty, and it is to help those who, hitherto, have found life rather too much for them that this book is being written. What the majority are seeking for is an easy life which they will never find, but precisely the reverse, and for them I have no message. But to those wise and awakened souls who are seeking for truth, no matter from whence it may come, and who desire to overcome life and its difficulties, instead of weakly giving in to them, this book, it is hoped, will bring a message. At this stage we cannot go into the subject of why we should meet with disasters and adversity in this life, nor why some people should have, apparently, a smoother life than others. Two, we must therefore be satisfied to know that we have to meet trouble and overcome difficulty, and that it is only by so doing that we can attain wisdom and build up character. The question then is not whether we shall meet the trouble and adversity or not, but rather, how we shall meet them. Shall we be victorious or shall we be submerged? Shall we overcome life's difficulties or shall we give in to them? The majority of people are drifters on the sea of life. They are wafted here and blown there. They are also carried hither and thither by every current. It is only the few who realize that they have the power of the infinite within them, by which they can rise superior to all their difficulties, overcome their own weaknesses, and through victorious experience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.